Hello, everybody. Balch, I'm coming to you live from my home in Suwanee, Georgia. Hope everybody is well out there. I'm going to go. Broadcast is about the upcoming project, Project 3, regarding building a classification-based trader, and Project 4, which is to do the same, but using reinforcement learning instead of a classification learner. Now, I'm going to go through the questions that I see on Piazza under the Ask the Prof link. I'll step through each question, and if there's follow-up questions, please add them as a new follow-up question on Piazza, and I'll get to those towards the end. So let me call up Piazza here real quick. It looks like there's also a chat here. Let's why don't somebody try and chat with me and see if that works. I'll type a testing question. That's me testing. That way to submit questions to me if that works. So I'll look for someone responding there. But first I'm going to go to Piazza and look for questions there. Okay, I'm just going to start with the questions and take them in order. There's not too many, so I don't have to read them out. The first question, and I'll repeat it, is, as beginner practitioners of ML techniques for stock trading, what would you set your guidelines for us students? Basically, what would you suggest in terms of how can we become more confident before putting large sums of money, large sums of our future employers, how can we become more confident before putting large sums of our future employers' money into a trade? What are the common pitfalls? Lucena, my company, what we do as we prepare a strategy for release or trading is, first we have we divide up our historical data into several chunks. We have in sample, where we allow our algorithms to optimize and perhaps overfit a little bit. Then we have what you can call out of sample or validation period, where we freeze our model, whatever it is, and we go forward and make sure we're still seeing the sorts of performance and statistics we had earlier. If it still looks good, we go into forward testing, which means the algorithm can only see what it can see today, and we paper trade it forward. If it continues to perform well, and that last test is the most important because it ensures that your algorithm is not time traveling at all. What I mean by time travel is it's not peeking into the future accidentally, which can happen. After it passes that last test and is performing well, then you can consider applying funds to it. Now, if you're working for someone like a hedge fund, they will answer that question for you. Every hedge fund has rigorous procedures and processes before they apply money to a strategy. They'll help you. You're not going to get into a position where you can suddenly be trading millions of dollars with some sorts of checks and balances. And every hedge fund has their own individual approach to that. Okay, there were some other questions in that one. What are the common pitfalls? Well, actually, I have a whole blog about this, and you can look it up. It's nine things that cause back tests to lie. I'll try and summarize some of the top ones. Number one is using survivor biased data. I believe I talk about that in the course, but essentially what it means is you're using data that only concerns current existing stocks. So for instance, if you're using the current membership of the S&P 500 and you're going back in time and say testing a strategy through 2008 to 2009 with the current members of the S&P 500, your strategy is going to be biased to the upside. Even if you just pick random stocks from that set, you'll outperform the S&P 500. I'll let you think about why that is. Another common flaw is accidentally peeking into the future. Those are probably the biggest ones. So in your development process, you need to have approaches for making sure that none of your strategies are peeking into the future. Another one that's common is building a strategy and testing it entirely in sample and believing that you're actually going to get performance like that in the future. It's almost always the case, it's guaranteed to be the case, that out of sample you're going to perform more poorly. Okay, we got this. Awesome. I'm going to scroll to the bottom and make sure there's no message like, oh, we can't hear you kind of thing. Okay, there's no message like that. Okay, good. Okay, I'll take the second question now. And any questions I don't answer here live, I'll go ahead and answer on Piazza after we're finished here. Next question from Christopher. You have stated several times that this course doesn't equip us with all the tools we need to start trading. What additional resources and knowledge would you suggest we acquire to cross that threshold? So the main reason I make this statement several times is because I don't want people to think this is some sort of overhyped get-rich-quick scheme or something. The name of the course is very, I don't know what the right word is, attractive, externally people might think it seems a little bit cheesy or get rich quick, and I want to dispel that. It's a quick introduction to a lot of the things you will need to be concerned about. I see lots of questions on Piazza that are correct, well-formed questions, you know, like, well, shouldn't we be doing that? You know, as an example, some of the recent questions are, don't we need a validation and a testing set of data? Those are true. And the fact that you're thinking about those questions means you're thinking in the right direction. But we cover so much material, we don't go into each topic really in as much detail as you really need to know it before trading live. In answer to your question more directly, what additional resources and knowledge do you suggest? The most important is building some sort of strategy or approach. You'll discover what you need as you try to do this, okay? But a next step is build the infrastructure that you need for some sort of daily trading strategy. What are you gonna need? You're gonna need data. So you're gonna need a way to collect data each day, process it, and propose trades. Next step, and you need that to run reliably. One interesting story, when I was at a hedge fund, we had a very expensive data feed, Thomson Reuters. It cost about $100,000 a year. We got that automated and integrated with our system. Suddenly the strategy stopped working as well as it should. And actually I noticed that for some reason we weren't trading any stocks beginning with the letter A through L. And what had happened is Thomson Reuters for about a week just stopped delivering data for stocks A through L. And we contacted, and you know, that we had only been trading about half the universe. We contacted them, and interestingly enough, we were their first client to discover this. And they said, oh yeah, we've got a bug that's causing all that data not to be sent. Anyways, after you have experiences like that and you realize you have to have checks to make sure you're getting all the data and so on. You need to have those experiences before you really know everything you need to do. Anyways, long story short, the quickest way to learn those lessons is to start trying to do it. Aim first for paper trading, where you're not trading live money, but you are entering trades as you go on. You're not peeking into the future at all. The next step, the next most informative and learning-centric process is to start trading. When you're trading with live money, that makes it a lot more real than just paper trading. You've got a much stronger incentive to solve any problems you encounter and so on. Outlining resources and knowledge, number one resource is data, reliable, consistent data. Yahoo isn't it. Usually you need also data besides just price and volume data. You need survivor bias data, of course. Knowledge, having knowledge, actually trading and experiencing what it's like is important. There's lots more, but the point of this course is just to expose you to each of those potential problems and, you know, motivate you to go more deeply. Okay. Here's a question. Next question by Evan. This is about the upcoming project. I would like to know what the README needs to have as far as explaining the project. Can we say run such and such a file and so on? Yes, so it's fine for you to create a script. You might call it main.py or something that automates all of the steps. Otherwise, you should enumerate all of the steps in your readme.txt file. Sorry, we got our neighbors mowing the lawn. I hope you can still hear me well. anyways, I just wanted to be outside because it's such a pretty day. Anyways, starting point for the TAs is to look at readme.txt, and it's okay if you just direct this to another file to run. It is very important that you include, I'll bring the mic closer to my face, it's very important that you include all of the Python files necessary to run your code, because if the TAs see some sort of discrepancy, or you know, it seems like maybe your report is too good to be true or too bad to be true, whatever, they're going to look at your code and make sure that your code backs up your claims. So it's important that you include all of that code. Another question in this thread is, can you submit Jupyter notebooks? I think those notebooks are great. My students that are working with me use those for development and so on. But in the end, what matters is what's checked into GitHub or whatever particular source code control you're using. Anyway, the answer is no. You need to supply all the code and .py files. Okay, can you provide details on project 5? Yes, I'll give you a bit of an overview of it right now. It'll be posted soon. The basic idea is that the API, it's going to be a repeat, essentially, of the robot navigation problem, except there's going to be a requirement for you to replace the queue table with some sort of continuous learner. By continuous, what I mean is instead of a discrete state coming in, you're going to have two continuous variables coming in. And the map, the world that you're solving, is going to be continuous instead of grid-based. The typical way to solve this problem is with neural networks. You might look up, what is it, Pixels to Pong. There's a lot of new research in using deep neural networks combined with reinforcement learning. But anyways, the big picture is we're going to, you know, take this black box right now that contains the Q table, and remember it's indexed by state and action. We're going to throw that out and instead replace it with a continuous learner like a neural network that takes two continuous variables in, the X and Y location of the robot, and outputs. A traditional way to do it is you have four outputs, essentially a Q value for each of the possible actions. And so if your location, your XY location comes in, you look at the outputs of the, you know, each output represents a particular action. It's got the highest value, and that's the action you take. In terms of training this neural network, what you do is you, you use backpropagation. You know, so let's say it picked this action. Well, you have values here that represent the Q values for this state coming in and that action coming out. And remember, when you update what the Q value ought to be, you know, say, an improved value there. So what you want to do is you want to backpropagate on the one, well, on the information that you have, and you want to backpropagate it on the appropriate output. But anyways, I'll provide a couple references, but the key reference is pixels to Pong. It's intended to be an extremely hard problem. And remember that it applies only to the project scores, and you can get the 100% in the class even if you don't do this additional project. Okay. What is my favorite scary movie from that troublemaker Octavian? Octavian, you're great. Thanks for all of your activity and participation on Piazza. I really like to see that. What's my favorite scary movie? I have to say that it's Jaws. And it's funny, I watched Jaws. I made my kids watch Jaws a year or two ago, and they all laughed at how cheesy and fake it was. Watching it, it scared the hell out of me. Okay. I'm sure there's no problems with the audio quality or anything. We still have all means working. Okay, no comments about audio quality. It's taking an internet connection problem. Sorry about that. Looks like I may be having some problems. We're okay. Right. Just blaze through and hope everybody can hear me. Okay, next questions. This is from RT. Features of any prediction algorithm. I would love to hear from you a bit more on how noise versus information in a set of features. That's question one. Go about selecting indicators. Can we employ techniques or are there other standards? Three, a lot of questions here already. How prevalent is use of semi-synthesized or improvised success yes, I believe that feature selection times you really don't trust in the robot navigation problem. You know, where you are now is a key feature. That problem, though, is a little bit artificial, feeding you what we already know are important indicators. For other, sorry about that. Oh, no, he's not. Okay, I'll just have to speak loud. in our case at Lucena Research, we have hundreds of indicators. This is all 600. Well, and what commodity not to be such a great pay price predictor, whatever you're trying to do there. So yeah, you need to hone that down. In my experience, the largest number of indicators you want is 6 to 10. Even fewer is better. But Artie's question is, you know, which stitch are the one answers to that. One is intuition. So picking a handful of indicators, I believe you've seen other, not too terrible of an approach. Or some sort of machine learning technique to find the four or five. Okay, so what machine learning other four? There, the literature feature selection, you'll find lots and lots of publications. We've used two techniques. One is called forward-backward. The way forward-backward works is you look at all your indicators one by one, and you discover which one is the most predictive by itself. So now you're using that one. Now you look at all your other indicators in conjunction with that, one by one, and you test how predictive they are. Then you add the one that is most predictive coupled with the one you've already got. So you've got two. Now with those two, you check each additional one. So that's called the forward part. You keep doing that until prediction quality drops off, like the next one that you add causes prediction quality to go down. Now you test, that's the forward part, now you test dropping one. So you take all the ones you have and you remove them. You remove each one just by itself. You remove it and test it, test the resulting group. And you continue removing until, so usually there'll be one that if you remove it will improve the predictive quality of your model. You repeat that process until if you remove one more, predictive quality actually gets worse. So that's backwards. So forward, and you keep going forward and backward until you can't improve things by adding one and you can't improve things by dropping one. And that's your set of indicators. Now, this is a kind of local optima, but it still is reasonably fast and pretty good. Another technique is to instead use a genetic algorithm kind of approach. Actually, I've got a there's a webinar. If you look on YouTube, you know, Balch webinar genetic algorithm, I think you'll find it. But essentially, it's trying to solve the same problem. It's randomly selecting groups of, say, 6 or 8 indicators, evaluating them, using the best ones to go into a following following generation, and so on. Okay, so that's feature selection. PCA. I've looked a number of times at PCA in the context of stock price prediction and not found it to be very effective. Like PCA, it's great for lots of problems, but I haven't seen it work well in stock price prediction. There are a lot of people that use it, especially in risk models. I just haven't seen it really work that well. Okay, going on to the next question. This is from I don't even understand in principle how you can arrive at an trees. And then he goes through an example of example situations that are less than optimal. Let me give you a little bit of an answer here. So in solving this particular problem, project 3, we are forcing you to create a classifier that you will use for collecting long, short, or nothing. Can you define the optimal classifier? In fact, it would be sort of hard to define. The optimal classifier is one, given the constraints like what are the factors you're using, you must use a certain number of factors and you should have thresholds in each factor. The optimal classifier is one that will provide the highest return. Given those constraints, yes, there is such an optimal classifier that you could discover in sample. Remember, it's working in it's working in conjunction with the decision tree. And indeed, in sample, if your leaf size is 1, you can indeed find the optimal classifier with decision trees. Because what you'll do is each day identify whether you should have been long or short that day, because you know exactly what happens 21 days later. So with a leaf size of 1, you can absolutely create an optimal classifier. Now we have the added constraint that once it enters a position, you can't exit it for 21 days. And so I think, sorry, Gerald, I didn't read. Guessing you're saying is, I think in time, Outlast says, okay, 20, my return is say above 5% or whatever, whatever it is you want it to be. So I should enter a long position today. And boom, 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 21 days later, yeah, I'll make 5%. But I did say, 2 more days, the price might have gone lower and the future price might have gone higher. So optimal, making higher return days before I enter, I would have a better just buy today. And it also says buy 2 days later. The optimal thing would have been to wait until this trade. Because if you bought here and you can't trade again for 21 days, you would miss this opportunity a few days later. And that's true, and that's more about the constraints of this way that we are creating classifier, but then layering on top of it a trading strategy. So When I say strategy, then includes a lot of components. It includes, in our case, some prediction, turning that into an operational something that you can execute. And in terms of this type of learner, you have to enter a position and stick with it. Anyways, Gerald goes on to say something about Qlearning. Indeed, Qlearning probably can do better. I think Qlearning is actually the best way to solve trading problems. And that's why your next project is about Qlearning. So, Gerald, I think you'll do well on the Qlearning problem. Okay, next question. Will there be exemplary versions of MC3-P3 released to us for to view at any point after grading? After grading, I will be very happy for people to share their solutions here on Piazza, but absolutely don't do it until after after things have been graded. The reason I suggest for people to share them on Piazza is if we do it that way, I know for sure that the people who are sharing them, essentially give their permission to share them. Let me check real quick and make sure we're still connected. Yep, we're still connected. Good. Are there any plans for machine learning for trading PhD program? I appreciate your interest in that. It's obviously an interesting topic. I don't think it's quite as broad and deep enough. Well, it can obviously go very deep, but it's not quite big enough to merit it's an entire devoted PhD program. We are creating a PhD in machine learning that actually will begin accepting applications for that next year. And certainly someone working on a PhD in machine learning could choose to focus on trading problems. So if that is something you're interested in, I would explore the upcoming PhD in machine learning. From Daniel, if someone were to think about getting into machine learning for trading in the real world, what amount of money would you recommend they start with? A first part of the answer is I think it's hard for an individual to be competitive in this. You really need to be part of a trading group or hedge fund, and here's why. You need a reliable source of data, not just price data, but usually some sort of proprietary data that's got information, things like insider trading, some of the data sources we work with at Lucena include sentiment. So, for instance, there's a company who's mining Twitter 24/7 and composing that into a data feed that tells you about each stock, what people are saying on Twitter about it. There's other sorts of information like cell phone location information, things like how many people are in a home market. Hedge funds are building trading systems based on what's actually learning algorithm you're using. Information turns out to be than which particular learning algorithm you're using. Although I will say that in initial results with Qlearning, we're seeing that Qlearning really is well suited to trading problems. I think really that's the way to go if you are going to use machine learning for trading. What amount of money would you start with? So if you're going to create a hedge fund to do this, you need on the order of at least 5 people for at least a year to build your system before you start trading at all. My experience seen it. Even if you have some system kind of working, it's going to take a little bubble, and you need this is entirely updated. Someone so that's 3. Overall, you need it for you. Trading with, I think, at least $1 million, and you're that money touched by actually trading. You know, I would say, that answer. Here's a question about the project. I and Mark executed the output, the order files as required by the assignments. Do I need to add additional hooks or parameters? I can also generate the graphs. Include the code that you wrote to this, but I don't think we can code, but absolutely need the code. Question from Daniel. Do you have any experience of applying to cryptocurrencies? I don't have some currency based, not using cryptocurrencies, we're using Forex, the factors that influence reasonably all affect cryptocurrencies. In fact, it might be interesting to, when you're trading any currency, it only against. So, for instance, let's say you're trading U.S. versus to do with that is, one thing, if your account is based in U.S. dollars, buy a bunch of euro, I'll convert it back to U.S. dollars, and then if 10,000 in, out when you made 1,000. The way they believe one in comparison with the value is how you make your money. For instance, now you would trade a pair, your mark that position frequently to add a dollar against Bitcoin. I think it would make a lot of sense to currency. It Otherwise, you're taking it. Good. Is it plotlib to generate the charts in MC3-P3? So yeah, I guess this goes back to the, do we need the code for generating the plots? So my answer is no. Code for generating question. No, you don't have to use matplotlib. You can use. Okay, live note. We can't hear you on the YouTube. It's cutting out. Okay. Sorry about that. Get my connection. Okay, I'll tell you what I'll do is I will post the video so that I think the video won't have the dropouts. So I'll post the video. And you'll get it all without the dropouts. Sorry about that. But I need to continue on even though I'm dropping out. Anyways, no, you don't have to use matplotlib, and no, you don't have to include the code that generates your plots. During the course, all examples are on stock market. I see Forex is more liquefied. I think you mean liquid, and a larger market. So actually, later on, there's going to be a to Forex strategy. Extremely deep and a lot of leverage because very little in relation to one. But yeah, I think all of the factors you've all we've used for equities certainly works. Tyson asks, most of MC3-P3 is out of sample is a different story. I'm wondering what techniques are available to work to reduce it in. The key reason that we focus on, well, there's a couple different reasons, but a key reason we focused on in-sample data in this project is because if we only looked at out-of-sample, it would end up being very disappointing because you would discover it's really, really hard to build a machine learning strategy with price-only data that works well out-of-sample. So I wanted A, for you to get a little bit of excitement seeing it working in sample, and B, for you to see that there's not much hope of it working out of sample. So naturally you'll ask, well, how can we make it work well out of sample? The key answer there is you need better data. You need data that's got information in it. And by that I mean some sort of proprietary data for that sort of stuff. You know, in this course, we don't have the money to get proprietary data like that. The methods we use for building strategies, and when I say we, I mean Lucena, for building strategies that work decently out of sample, is we test lots of strategies in sample till we find some that work well. And of course, they're always going to work pretty well in sample no matter what. Then we test out of sample and we look for strategies that additionally, you know, in addition to in sample, they work well out of sample. Now that still doesn't mean that we didn't get lucky. Now we've got a candidate for four and we actually check it with paper trading. If it does well there, then we consider putting live money against. Other things, other approaches to avoid overfitting are one, just get some errors on this. You can look them up on YouTube. One is to have only a handful of factors. The fewer factors you have, the less likely you are to overfit. Another is to have a simple set of rules. And, you know, without too much depth or you know, leaf size of one is helps you avoid a complex rule set. Or you don't want to have them be too complex. And also, testing over a longer period of time, those together will help. And RSI, and how those could be used. Well, sure. The momentum is as the price change over some number 10 days. If I looked over, I would expect momentum over 10 days to range, somewhere between maybe 5% as a maximum and -5% as a minimum. You'll have a couple of outliers, maybe a -10%, like drug stocks sometimes drop hugely. But most of the time you're going to have your mean for momentum is probably going to be around 0%, maybe slightly positive because generally the stock market's going up. And then of about 1% above and below. So if you standardize that data, mean is probably going to be slightly above zero. Most of your numbers between 1 and -1. Anyways, you can use that directly as a as an indicator in this learning system. RSI is, I know it stands for relative strength indicator. I believe it involves volume. I'm sorry, the details of RSI, but I see people use it a lot. But if you standardize it in the same way, it's a good indicator. RSI is trying to tell you is if you're overbought or oversold. In other words, people believe that with RSI at a certain level, people have spent over some number of days buying a lot, and their energy in buying spent a drop in price. I don't want to talk too much detail about RSI because I'm afraid I'll get the specific thing wrong about it, but I will say that momentum, and I believe RSI as well, we'll use them typically or as so that's so very high sort of sorry, another size. By the way, larger bands. Larger bands are indicators. Remember, we're trying to find information about the particular stock that we're trading, right? In other words, we want to find how it's potentially different from other stocks. So the big picture is this classification learner may be used in the context of a broader portfolio. Instead of just trading one stock, what if we're trading 30? Okay, so we're looking, let's say in a 30 stock portfolio, we want to, looks like the sun's going to get on there. We want to find some group of stocks bet long on and some group of stocks that we can So we're looking for some piece of information distinct about each stock. So how can you do that? Well, one way you can do it is to compute these indicators for the stock you're looking at, but also for a market-wide symbol like SPY, and you can compare the relative values. Let's suppose Apple's blown out the top of Bollinger Bands, but the market is blown out the top as well. Well, if you're looking at a long-short strategy, it's likely that both of them are going to, you know, come down together, and so you're not benefiting anything special about Apple. On the other hand, if Apple's blown out the top and the market hasn't, that may be an indicator that there is something special about Apple, and it's worth it's going to be more predictive than otherwise. Next question from Eldar. For this project, can we put order in same day we have exit order? Yes. Do we need to trade on day one for a manual trader, or do we trade when conditions are optimal? You can start trading any day you want, but once you enter a position, you have to stay in it for 21 days. You can then, at the end of 21 days, you have to exit. You can re-enter long, you know, let's say you were long, you have to exit, and then if you want to stay long, re-enter, and you have to stay in that again for another 21 days. Now, if you're in 21 days and you want to stay long, you don't have to explicitly exit and re-enter. You can just stay in. But each time you stay in, it's got to be for another 21 days. You could also be in it for 21 days, exit, and go short on the same day. If a new stock comes in, how do you decide whether to invest in it or not, besides it being in the interest area? I don't know what you mean. In general, if you're talking about IPOs, the question of whether to invest in an IPO, you know, day one or not, it's not a question I think is well suited to machine learning, because there aren't enough examples to help you know that. Maybe there's a few thousand there, but they've come into markets where the market regime is so much different over time. I don't know if you can build a predictive model. The other question is, once it starts existing, can you believe the factors about it? You know, I would say in terms of a typical machine learning strategy, you would want to wait for a stock to be around at least 6 months to a year before you start trading it. Are we allowed to use libraries for project 5 like sklearn? No, you have to write all that code yourself. As for best possible strategy, do we need to trade on each high and low to achieve the highest possible return, or just approximately where we can visually see high, low point, and low point? Let's see. I'm not sure I totally get your question, but let me just tell you this. For the best possible strategy, you are allowed to trade daily, which means you can enter one day, exit the next, and enter a new position on that same day. And I would do that because you can look into the future. I would trade every single day and just look at whether tomorrow does the stock go up or not. If it goes up, I would buy it. If it goes down, I would short it. Maybe too low level. From Miriam, what's the difference between normalization? Sorry, I'm moving around a little bit here. What's the difference between normalization and standardization? So normalization actually means more standard. I would say that standardization is a kind of normalization. When I say normalization, I don't know where I learned it, in geometry or something. What I mean when I say normalization is you want to adjust things so that the value on the first day is always 1.0. So if you want to normalize stock prices, you divide your time series by the value on the first day. That causes it to be 1.0 on the first day, and then the cumulative return is easy to calculate after that. That's what I mean by normalization. Standardization means over some period of time, you take the mean value and the standard deviation, and you calculate the standardized value by each day. You subtract the mean. You subtract the mean and divide by the standard deviation. Miriam later says I can skip that. Okay, too late. Bollinger Band, about the Bollinger Band feature, it has two different definitions. I don't care so much what version of Bollinger Band you use. In fact, you don't even have to use Bollinger Bands. The key thing is one of the definitions affords standard deviation, or I'm sorry, is very close to standardization. So you don't have to, it's not strictly necessary to additionally standardize Bollinger Bands, because it's close to being standardized already. Okay. All right, I'm going to try to wrap up soon here. This is from Shin. If look-back day is changed for a technical indicator, how do we determine the best threshold to buy or sell? The answer is that's what machine learning is for. If you want to know what is the most effective look-back day, you might run your machine learning algorithm on the indicator with different look-back days. That's how we do it at Lucena. So the question is, let the data tell you the answers to those questions. Okay, for part five, what data belongs on what axis? For the horizontal, you pick two indicators. So this is for part five of MC3-P3. You pick two indicators, whichever ones you like. The horizontal axis should be for one indicator. The vertical axis should be for the other indicator. Now you're going to have a bunch of dots, one dot for each day in the period that you're looking at. If you're looking at 2 years, we ought to have about 500 dots, because there were 500. There ought to be 504 days, except in a leap year. So we've got 500 dots. Now, each one should be colored red, green, or black, depending on whether that dot represents a long or a short or a do-nothing day. Okay, I think I answered that question. Another question from Miriam, not directly related to machine learning for trading, but since you mentioned it as an ancillary tool and since we discussed it, when will natural language processing be offered online for it? I don't know the answer to that question. I believe I saw an email that course is in preparation, but it takes at least a year to create one of these courses for OMSCS, so I can't predict when it'd be available. Sorry, I don't know that. Last question from Ki Wong. Most of the technical indicators use rolling windows. What's the recommendation on choosing the size of the window? What's the recommendation on choosing the size of the window respective to the holding period? So that's a good question. I would say that for a in-day hold, in this case, say it's 21 days, you need, and this is just a hunch, okay? I think it's worthy of some experimentation, but I think you need at least 21 days of data if you're going to make a decision for 21 days in the future. And I think maybe more look back would be necessary. So something like 63 days look back for a 21 day hold. Okay, I'm going to wrap up now. I'm sorry that the audio dropped out a little bit, but if you go back and look at the link after it's been processed, I think you'll find that it's better without those dropouts. And I apologize for having had those dropouts. And thanks for paying attention, and good luck on the project. And I'm signing out.